Hello, everyone, and welcome to People of Interest. I'm your host, Miguel Guanipa. People of Interest is a show based on stories from people like me and you. Today, I have a very special guest. He's a very skilled woodcraftsman and a very funny guy. His name is Michael Gadsby with a D, correct?
Correct.
Thanks for joining me, Mike.
Already.
I'm gonna take a whole hour away from your life today, if you don't mind.
That's fine with me.
All right. So what, we're just talking about one of the things that you do. I've seen some of your work. You got very nice pieces of wood for cutting and things that they do with different kinds of wood and all.
Right.
Very nicely made, very solid. So I was wondering, how did you? When did you become interested in doing that? When did that happen? Do you remember that?
Making my cutting boards?
Yeah, or making starting to be interested in working with wood.
I took it for in high school for a year, and then when I bought my house and had to do stuff, I just figured out that.
So high school was a long time ago. Though,
it's not that long, huh?
No,
it's like yesterday.
Like yesterday. Well, how did you decide when you were in high school? Gee, I like to look into this. Do you remember that?
Yeah. In high school, I tried to take all the electives because I didn't want to do the English and the math. I took the woodworking and graphic arts and.
Yeah. You did some graphic arts too? You like doing that?
Yeah. It was mostly like printing and stuff.
Yeah.
But and then I took drafting.
And, oh.
Yeah. Took home economics because you had to. Learned how to sew and cook.
Yeah. I'm surprised they don't teach those things anymore in high school, you know?
Yeah,
Those things are helpful.
Right, because not everybody's going to be able to do a white-collar job, so.
Yeah. So you grew up in town, in Blackstone?
Right.
Is that where you grew up?
Yep. And then they didn't have... I didn't make it to the vocational school.
That's the Blackstone Valley?
Right. Couldn't pass the test, but...
Yeah. So then what was that? That was after high school or something? Or
I was in high school. You could have went there and, learned a trade.
Yeah.
You do,
What were you hoping to learn to go there? What was your aspiration?
I probably would have did carpentry.
Okay.
I like working with my hands.
So you're a pretty good craftsman as it is. So it's that didn't.
Right.
You didn't really kind of.
I decided if somebody couldn't teach me, I was gonna have to learn on my own. So
you did it on your own.
I was just like a sponge.
You like you that kind of a person? You think a kind of person that likes to learn things on your own, or do you pick things up pretty good when it comes to handy things, or?
I don't know if I pick them up pretty good, but yeah. If I want to do something, I just get as much information about it as I can and give it a whack.
Huh.
And then,
so that's pretty good. So if you wanted to do something,
right,
you do the research and then you pursue it and then you achieve your goals, which is
right.
What you've done.
Right. You always want to try and make yourself better.
When you grew up, how many siblings do you have?
There's four of us all together. It's me and three sisters.
Three sisters? So I said one of them, a couple of them are older and a couple of them are younger? Or?
One is older, other two are younger.
Okay. So when you grew up, who was the boss in the family?
Who was the...
Out of everybody and the little kids.
That would be my dad, but...
No, I mean for the kids.
Oh, for the kids?
Yeah.
probably my older sister.
Yeah.
Call her Mother Teresa.
Mother Teresa? Is she really good?
Very
kind?
No, she won't let you, do what you want to do, the fun stuff that you're really not supposed to be doing, right? She always,
She won't let you do it?
Right. Even now,
So she's kind of strict or something in some areas, or?
Not so much strict, but she'll let you know that...
Something's wrong. You shouldn't be doing something.
whatever you do, you're not supposed to be doing. Like,
but that's not all she does, though, right? That's the good things that she does.
Oh, oh, yeah, but yeah, so.
So that's, but that's not a bad thing that she does that.
Right.
So then you went, you picked up the woodwork, but at the same time, what, as you were growing up, like, what was life as a kid for you? Like, you know, what was some of your experiences as a kid in the neighborhood?
As a kid in the neighborhood?
Yeah. You have a lot of friends in the neighborhood. You have a hang around. You.
Yeah. And then when I was a teenager, they'd have Diamond Hill in Woonsocket. It was like the place to be.
Yeah.
And that was probably at least a 30-minute walk from my house. Like, just like a shopping plaza where everybody would hang out.
Oh, it was like a mall?
Pretty, yeah. But not so much like a mall, but just like a shopping plaza. Just like the Hannafords, but like bigger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And everybody who was anybody would be there.
Yeah. All your friends would be there and hang out with
you
them.
You walk there, and then once you get your license, you could drive there. And anybody that was anybody was there.
All the people that with the connections.
Right. And there was two sides of the plaza, so the cops would come kick you out of one, and you would just find your way to the other one, and it was like a...
Is that
it's like the cat and mouse game there. All right, he's going to come get me over here, so we're going back down here.
Why would they kick you out? Loitering or something?
Pretty much. There'd be like a lot of people there. I mean,
oh, is that right?
There'd be well over 100 people hanging up in cars and in the parking lot.
Oh, like they show in the movies in the 50s, kind of?
Pretty much, yeah.
So it's just hanging out in their cars?
Yeah.
Who did you have, a person that was your best friend there that you hung out with? Or?
Yeah, there was four or five of us from the neighborhood that would always hang out.
Yeah.
We would do, a lot of times we were walking there until you got your car and your license.
Mm-hmm.
And then you would drive there.
That's what you like to do? That was fun to do that?
Yeah, that was pretty much like the only thing to do.
Hmm. Okay, so let's go back a little bit to your family then. When you were growing up, you decided, okay, I'm gonna maybe I'll pursue this thing, doing woodwork and doing some of these things, some of these crafts and things, because you go to shows also, right?
Right.
So how's that going? Is that going pretty good for you, that side little thing that you do with the wood, or?
I can afford to do things that I probably wouldn't, like vacations.
Yeah.
Bought a camper.
Also, you do okay with it.
Yeah.
Okay. And so something interesting that you told me, that you said, something about you sell your work to people who lead lifestyles.
That I don't live.
That you don't live.
Right.
What do you mean by that? What were you trying to say in that sentence?
I live like a simple life, like, I don't need like fancy things, but I like to make fancy things.
Yeah.
But I'm just a simple guy. I mean, I go to work, I come home, try to make the wife happy.
Mm-hmm.
Even though my woodworking has become like a second job, but I could be like stressed out knowing that I have orders to fill. But I don't mind like going out there to make stuff.
Mm-hmm. So the truck driving is your full time job, kind of.
Right.
And that's something that you also enjoy doing.
Yeah, I like driving.
Okay. But it also gives you an opportunity to be home. It's not like you go driving really far places, away.
I mostly go to I always call it Northern Mass, but like Lawrence, Methuen, Dracut, Southern New Hampshire.
So how did you get that job? You were telling me a story about that you got that job. What was it that happened?
I started truck driving.
Yeah, when you started, yeah.
I worked for Autocrat Coffee in Lincoln, Rhode Island.
Mm-hmm.
And they needed an 18-wheeler backed into the dock. There was nobody around to do it. So told him I'd give a stab at it, and I got it in for a shot. Mm-hmm. So I'd already been delivering. They called them AT trucks, but I was already driving a box truck to deliver to restaurants and nursing homes and stuff. So
yeah.
But to drive an 18-wheeler, you need a commercial driver's license. So I taught myself pretty much how to drive a truck. I got my permit. They would send me out with the regular truck drivers, and that's where I'd get my experience. I took my test. Had to do it 3 times to get my license.
Yeah.
And then...
But you got it.
I got, yeah. One thing I learned, because I did it twice, because my first time getting a CDL, I got what they call a CDLB, which is just a straight truck. And then the second time I went for the license to get to drive the 18-wheelers.
Mm-hmm.
But I found out if you're doing it on your own, that you never make it the first time, because all the instructions, all the people are giving you a test working at their schools. So
yeah.
But so the first one it took me 3 times to get, and the second one took me 2 times. And then I got my 18-wheel license in 94.
Mm-hmm.
And then I haven't been doing it since then, but the place I work for now, the first 2 years I drove, and my kids were getting to the age of going to school.
Yeah.
So I had to find a night job so I'd be home during the day to get them on the bus, off the bus. So I was going to leave the job that I have now for another job, but they liked me, so, and they were running 3 shifts, so they told me to come in at night and keep myself busy.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so there, I ran the dock. I would set up the runs for the next day, load the trucks. And I did that for 12 years. And then my kids were old enough, and I bid back on driving.
Hmm. How many children do you have?
Two. I have two boys.
Two boys? What are they up to these days?
My oldest actually works at the same company that I do, that I work with. And my youngest is in school. Or pandemic mode is in his bedroom on a computer.
Yeah, with the Zoom.
Right. Yeah.
He's going to school. Where is he going to school? Is it high school or college?
Oh, college. Oh. Going to RIC, Rhode Island College.
Yeah. What does he want to do?
He's gonna be computer science. He's gonna work in IT.
Wow.
I have one that's life smart and book stupid.
Streetwise,
and then the other one is book smart and life stupid.
So to be nice, we can say one of them streetwise, but
I shouldn't say that. The older one is like me, like has to be interested in whatever he's doing to do it, and the other one is he's book smart.
That's book smart, yeah.
But I think it has a lot to, because they're 3 years apart. And the little one, you know, always wanted to hang out with the older one.
Yeah.
But the older one never wanted anything to do with him. But for 3 years, my second son, Jacob, had to watch his brother get on the bus.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted to get on the bus. So, and this is just my opinion. And then once he finally got on the bus, he was going to do whatever he had to do to stay on that bus with his brother.
Yeah.
I think that's why he's so good in school.
Why did he want to go in the bus?
That's where his older brother was going. Oh. He had to wait. They're 3 years apart, so
the younger one wanted to get in the bus.
Right. He wanted to go.
Oh, okay.
Some days he would cry because he couldn't get on the bus with his brother.
Oh, like, is that?
Don't worry, buddy. You'll have your shot.
You'll have your shot someday.
Once you get on the bus, you'll realize that you don't want to be on the bus.
So he's going to school, and he's going to be working computer science. And that's a pretty interesting field.
Yeah.
So with this this whole situation that we're in right now, how has that kind of affected your job? Not much, you were saying? That
no, it's just on my end, nothing's changed. I still go to work. I still have to work.
Yeah.
Probably 50, 60 hours a week. And then, I mean, There was times that we weren't delivering flooring. We were going to, they call it outside freight, but going to like Polo Beverage and picking up a load of soda to bring it to Jersey or somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
But my company's almost like I stay in New England or New Hampshire, but we have guys coming from Jersey with trailers, and then we'd pick up something around here that's going back that way, and they would just take that trailer with them.
Mm-hmm.
See, not really. I've been to Jersey a few times, but I went when New York City was like the pandemic. It was like the hot spot.
Yeah.
But you would get to the George Washington Bridge, and you pretty much put it in park, and I'm like, I can't believe like all these people are sick, and there's still all this traffic on the bridge.
Oh, is that right? So it's pretty busy still.
Yeah.
Kind of slow down afterwards.
But it's still like, it was still like busy.
Yeah.
And then I went to Long Island the morning after they had the riots in Manhattan.
Mm.
And people, I was driving down the Long Island Expressway and two trucks pulled over and get out in the breakdown lane and started fighting on the side of the road.
Really?
I'm like.
Like physically fighting?
Physically, yeah. Fist fighting.
Wow.
And I had a guy with me, and I'm like, thank God that happened now. And he's like, what do you mean that happened now? I'm like, oh, that happened like a half hour ago. We'd be stuck in traffic.
Well, that's that's pretty interesting. But I'm wondering when you were younger, do you remember those times when you were a kid and with your friends? What were some of the things that you did with your friends that was most entertaining, that you enjoy the most?
Mostly just like hanging out.
Yeah.
Mucking it up.
Mucking it up?
Mucking it up, yeah.
How did you meet your wife?
I was set up on a blind date with her.
Yeah, by whom?
By, let's see. I just, friend Lee, his girlfriend's, her friend.
Yeah.
But I had gone up.
A friend of hers or a friend of yours?
A friend of hers.
Oh, okay.
My friend's girlfriend's friend.
Mm-hmm.
But I had gone out with a girl that my friend, I'd gone out with one of my wife's best friends before that, but.
Does she know that?
Yeah, that's how I found out, like, after when I met my wife.
Yeah.
So
it was your friend's girlfriend had a girlfriend, and that was your, she was the blind date for you.
She was the one that set me up with my wife.
To set you up with your wife. So this friend of yours is one of your best friends, or?
Yeah. I don't really have friends.
Yeah.
It had to be like five of us that grew up in the neighborhood. We just hang out.
Mm-hmm. But are they still around? Still.
There's. Let's see. One's a police chief in Upton.
Hmm.
Another one. I can't. He lives in Blackstone. This year we didn't have it, but usually in January after the holidays, they have like what they call like a Christmas party.
Mm-hmm.
We'd go hang out at one person's house.
So these five friends that you hung out from in the past, you still hang out with them?
Not so much, but see them here and there.
Yeah.
Just life happens. You get married, have kids, and
yeah,
a million things to do.
So since you can pretty much, if you wanted to learn something, you can go yourself and you can kind of like commit yourself to finding out about it and learn it, right? That's the kind of guy that you are in a way, right?
Right.
When you learn how to drive, the truck on your own, how to figure that out?
Almost everything in life, I pretty much self-taught.
Yeah.
Anything that I wanted to do. And now it's easy with the internet because you got YouTube. You can learn how to do anything on YouTube.
What are you? What are some of your other interests that you have that you like to that you would like to do, or to learn?
I just to get better as a woodworker. It's all I do to try and just make myself better, make better things.
Do you have other interests, other things that interest you that you're like, oh boy, I like to learn that, really find out how to do that?
Not so much. I just like watching baseball and football.
What do we have back there? We have
I'm forced to watch. I'm forced to watch hockey. I don't mind hockey. I like the fights, but my wife is like the hockey fanatic.
Oh, she likes the hockey.
She likes the hockey.
Oh,
so I follow along, so I know what she's talking about.
Just watch it for the fights.
I'm watching for the fights. So
yeah.
She's watching, like, all I know is if you get in the other guy's goal, it's a point. But she's talking about icing and...
She's got all the terminology.
Yeah,
she knows.
I'll be like, yeah. Like,
you going on vacation lately anywhere? Or
no.
Taking some time off? Or?
Every year we go to Maine. Even this past year, we still went. That was like a whole ordeal because they'd have like the... You have to quarantine.
Oh, okay.
My wife would be all like freaked out, and I'm like, if you get pulled over, all you got to tell them is you're here for the day. She goes, how are you going to tell somebody that you're in Conway, New Hampshire, and you're here for the day? I'm like, what's wrong with that?
There's a lot of people that probably have to do that because, you know, you can't go anywhere then.
Right. I mean, they're not going to not take your money. Like, it's the same thing like camping. Like, you're renting a site. You're doing your thing. You wave to your neighbor, but it's not like you're not going over to their camper.
So talk about your family a little bit. How do you remember your father?
Oh, my father. He did all the talking and you did all the listening. he was like very set in his ways,
he's very firm,
right?
Yeah,
like it was his way or no way, and usually it was no way, but
he was like that with all the children, or?
For the most part, I mean, he had his favorite, but...
Yeah? It wasn't you, I guess.
Because I was the only boy, so I was, I'll say, like, raised different than...
You were the favorite?
I wasn't the favorite.
Oh, okay.
But, like, the girls were the favorite with him because they were his girls, so...
Yeah.
But he was stricter with me because I was the boy, so...
I would think probably some of the girls also can cause trouble.
He had a better relationship with them than me, probably because they were girls.
Yeah.
Like, he was like strict, like you gotta do this, and then them, it was a little different because they could.
Why do you feel that he was more strict with you?
Oh, because he was.
I mean, what would be the reason? Did you get into a lot of trouble? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
I get in my fair trouble, but... It was his way or no way.
Yeah. What about your mother? Was she also strict or was she a little softer?
She was a little softer. She was the one that you went to, right, to get something.
To get something,
like if you wanted something, well, like in, you wouldn't ask my dad because everything you asked him was like no.
Really? Everything?
Pretty much, yeah.
Wow, did he ever say yes?
Not too much, huh?
Do you remember him saying yes once?
Nope.
Wow.
But so I got a paper out when I was 10, and as soon as I was making my own money, I had to buy all my own clothes.
Yeah. Wow. But
whatever I wanted, I had to find a way to get. But he was the only one working.
Yeah.
And they had a mortgage. Like, I wasn't happy then, but like later on, like now, I can is pretty much say no because it was like there wasn't no money. I mean,
mm-hmm.
We didn't go on vacations. We like he took a week off and we would do like day trips to like Paragon Park, which is not there no more. That's like that was like the Six Flags of the day.
Paragon Park, where is that at?
It was in Hull, Mass.
Oh, okay.
Used to have Rocky Point. We never went there. It was weird. We lived so close to Rhode Island, like, but we never, like, growing up, we never really did anything in Rhode Island. It was always going to Boston or.
So he didn't make a lot of money, so there wasn't a lot of vacations and stuff, you said?
Right.
Oh, okay. And then he didn't say no because he didn't say no because he wanted to say no. It's because he couldn't say yes, you're saying? Like, he couldn't afford some of the things that you would have wanted?
Probably.
Hmm. But, I mean, do you think about it and go back and think, I wonder why he said no so many times, or do you wonder why, not just because he was a tough guy?
I realized now having my own house and wife and kids that money's, like, always tight.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I started selling my woodwork back in 2008 when the economy tanked. Cause I started selling my stuff because I needed the money.
Right.
But now I don't so much need the money, but I like the interaction with the people.
Mm-hmm.
I always like to talk.
So you always find a way if you need something.
Pretty much.
So maybe that's something you think that your father taught you? The tough way?
Right, yeah. I'm happy. I'm, like, happy now. Like, you understand, and then you gotta work.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but back then, not so much.
Back then, it was a little different.
The only thing, my father was a green thumb, like, that. The only envy I had is, like, I never had to cut the grass because that was his thing.
Yeah.
He liked cutting the grass and planting flowers, so. All my friends had chores of cutting the grass. My father would always tell me, if you touch the lawnmower, I'm going to break your fingers. Why would me?
Was it a nice lawnmower? Or?
No, but...
He was into...
That was his thing.
Huh. Well, that sounds like, at least I guess he taught you some things for life, right?
Right.
Huh. What was something like, do you remember, we were talking about it was a tough time back then. Do you remember an instance where you had a very difficult event in your life happen, and then you pulled out of it, you figured out a way to get out of it, and how was that? And tell me about that.
I don't know what you... That I had?
Yeah.
It's an
experience in your life that was a difficult experience. But you worked through it and you figured out how to get out of it and you finally got out of it. And how did that change you?
I don't know that I...
You haven't had any tough times?
It's just like life in general,
Yeah, just an experience that you had.
Is when I met my wife, but I didn't know if I wanted.
You're not gonna get in trouble, so don't worry about it.
When I met my wife, I probably wasn't like in the right frame of mind.
Yeah.
We dated for a year and then we broke up. And then like going the wrong way.
Mm-hmm.
So I went back with my wife because I knew, I felt in my heart that that's where I should be. So, and I went back, but but my wife always thinks that I came back because somebody else told me that I should go back.
Yeah.
But I had a friend that saying that, you know, if that's where you want to be, then that's where you need to be. So I went back out with my wife, and I've been with her ever since.
So she thought that somebody had sent you, or it was your own decision?
Yeah. She's always under the impression that somebody told me that I should go back with her.
Yeah.
But
does she know now that that wasn't the case, that it was you that made that decision?
You'd have to ask her.
Well, you just told her, so now she knows. When she watches this, she'll realize, oh, so you come on your own.
I don't know. She'll always have her doubts.
I'm sorry?
She'll always have her doubts.
My wife was telling me something about you one time at a show. I don't know if you remember this, but you can tell me if you remember. And it was a lady was coming out of a store with a paper bag, I believe. And she had something that was cold in the paper bag, so the bottom of the bag broke. And all her things kind of fell on the ground. And so then my wife told me that everybody was just kind of staring at the woman, not doing anything. But then you went over and you gave her a couple of plastic bags.
Right.
Do you remember that situation?
I don't know if I remember it, but that's something I would do.
Yeah. Well, that's a good thing that you did that.
Yeah.
But my wife was telling me a story and saying, oh, you know, that guy that Mike gave us the table, that was very kind of like moved by that, because she thought nobody was helping the lady, but you just kind of did the practical thing and you just, hey, here's some bags where you can put your stuff in there. So that was pretty good.
Yeah, I'll tell you that's something that I would do, but sometimes that's something that I wouldn't do. Oh.
You never know.
Right.
You don't know. When you're living through your life, what is it that you look at for inspiration to guide you, to guide your life in the way that you act or live?
Well, I just like to try to make people like happy. Well, at the end of the day, I tell my wife all the time, at the end of the day, I just want to make you happy. And it's just always an ongoing thing.
That's a good goal.
Right, yeah. But my parents, I probably get that from my parents. My parents were always like doing stuff. Like, they'd give people like rides to the store that didn't have a car. Or,
mm-hmm.
But I don't know if I was like raised that way. I probably was just seeing. But, I mean, you got to help people out. Everybody has a struggle.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Just, like, anything. Like, I just do it.
Well, that's good. That's a good thing. But just so you know that she told me that story, and it was good for her to see that. So that's a nice thing that Mike did. Nobody was helping that lady, and like it wasn't like a big struggle to help the lady. So.
It's like I work. They just want you to like get the stuff off the truck, but they don't understand that there's still like customer service involved with anything. Like you can't say hey, just take your crap. I gotta go because my company's only giving me 3 minutes to get this 500-pound carpet off my truck. It's like. Mm-hmm.
Do you find yourself that you want to go a little above and beyond the extra mile on your job, or?
Yeah, for the most part, but I also don't want to do anything more than I have to do. Like,
yeah.
So, because I can work 14 hours a day, the place I work for is always trying to get you to work the average day is probably like 12 hours, but then there's always times where you'd only have like 8 stops and you'd be back in like 6 hours, and they'd be like, I'm like, nothing, because I've worked like, it's like Wednesday and I already got like 40 hours in, and Thursday rolls around, I have a short day and you guys just want to keep.
Yeah.
I'm like, I said, just because I can work 14 hours a day doesn't mean I want to work 14 hours a day. So.
Is there something in your life when you were younger that you thought it was kind of a dream that you had, that you thought, gee, that would be a wonderful thing, you know, for to happen?
I'll say no. I've always just said
you don't have to.
Take it day by day.
Take it day by day, one day at a time.
Right.
So you're basically a pretty happy guy. There's nothing, you know, a lot of things that rattle you.
No, but I can be rattled, but.
What are the things that rattle you?
Probably just like pressure.
Yeah. But with the work that you do, if you work 14 hours a day sometimes, that could probably be some pressure there, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, well, driving a truck, you have to have like a short memory. It's like, so it doesn't become like monotonous. Like,
you have to have a short memory.
Yeah, you can't remember like you always remember the customers that are pain in the butt, but like the only thing, like good, like you can mix it up. I found I work better if I'm by myself.
Yeah.
Like. Me and that guy in your head all the time that's like keeping you on the right track.
the guy in your head?
Yeah.
Who's that?
I don't know. He's another me. Like, he's the guy that keeps me honest.
Yeah. So there's like your conscience, you mean? Or?
I'll say yeah. I mean. It's like when you come to like a situation where you could do the wrong thing or the right thing.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But I've always stuck with the right thing.
Because there's that other guy telling you.
Pretty much.
Well, that's good.
It's like when you find like $50 on the ground and. There's people around.
And you found my $50?
I didn't find your $50. Sometimes, like what?
Oh, I thought that I did lose $50. So if you come across them.
I'm a married guy. The one thing I don't have is money. No.
So you're kind of a funny guy too. You're kind of a jokester too, a little bit.
Yeah.
You like to tell jokes.
Yeah. That's to break the ice.
Do you like watch comedy or people that are? Do you have a favorite comedian that you watch that you like?
No, but lately I've been getting this TikTok stuff on my phone. So
oh, the TikToks.
And they're like lip syncing, like comedy acts. And,
oh, yeah. I know about those.
Those are, the one I heard that was funny is that they're asking the girls, like, so why is it that you're not dating? Oh, because my roommate doesn't like me taking my friends home, and then you hear the guy in the background, for the last time I'm telling you, we're married. So.
So that's some of that interesting humor there.
Right.
Those TikToks.
But I won't sign up for it, but I don't know. They come up on my phone, so I'll watch them for a little bit, have a good chuckle. And
you didn't sign up for I get them all the time from my daughter send me the TikToks.
I didn't sign up for it, but I think I watched a video somewhere that was a TikTok. Yeah. So now it just comes as like a notification on your phone.
Oh, okay. All right.
Some of them are, a lot of them are like a repeat, but they're trying to suck me in getting onto TikTok, and that'll.
That's
when you sit down and watch it on YouTube, then you can like, you know. You're like, damn, 8 hours going by already.
it goes by fast.
Right.
It goes by fast. So what do you got planned for the future? You got any fun ideas that Do you want to do with the wife somewhere, go somewhere, or do something?
I think we're just going to travel with the camper.
Yeah.
Last year, we were supposed to go to Virginia, but then the COVID started. That's probably, like, the good thing. Like, we went to Maine, because we go to Maine every year for, like, the last 30. But,
yeah.
So you couldn't travel with COVID, especially to, like, Virginia, but we could go back to Maine.
What's in Maine? What do you go see in Maine?
Old Orchard Beach.
Yeah.
I've been going the whole time that I knew my wife. So now it's like, well, like the last 10 years, it's like, really? We're going back to Maine? I'm like...
When did you start going to Maine?
When I was dating my wife.
Oh, okay.
She had never been, like, really, like, anywhere. Mm-hmm. Per se, like, so I took her to Old Orchard Beach because I had a cousin that had a cabin there, and we went. They had, like, the amusement park.
Yeah.
So, and then she just liked going there. Almost every year, we go at least for a weekend.
So you started with your cousin because he had a cabin over there.
Right, yeah. Okay. He came down and gave my parents a break. He took the four of us up there.
Oh.
And that was, like...
Oh, that's nice.
That was probably in the 80s, and he was already living off the grid. He had a cabin that somebody had made. He was renting it, but it had no electricity. It had a stream out back. First time I ever saw it, it was like where Poland Spring gets there. What was it, like spring water?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. First stream I ever saw where you could, like, see the bottom. It was just always clear.
Yeah.
But that water was cold. That's it. Like, he told us to get a 5-gallon bucket and wash yourself up in the bathroom. Like, he had no running water. He was off the grid.
Wow.
And that was in the 80s. So I'm like,
is he still over there?
Nah, but.
So when you go to Maine, what do you go to now?
Mostly the same places. Well, we've been going so long now, so now we stay in Biddeford, Maine, which is right outside of Old Orchard Beach.
Biddeford, yeah.
And we drive an hour and 20 minutes to Conway, New Hampshire for the day.
What's happening in Conway?
Just like the outlets and...
Oh, okay.
And then trying to get my wife to go to Bar Harbor, but it's a...
Do you like Bar Harbor?
I never been, but I heard it's nice.
Oh, she doesn't like to move around too much, your wife?
She likes the same spot.
Huh?
So that's the same.
Well, that's kind of good in a way.
Yeah, but like, so we stay in Biddeford, which is like the lower part of Maine.
Mm-hmm.
But Bar Harbor is still 2.5 hours away.
What's the most interesting place that you've gone in your truck driving days?
I'd say once you get to like New York City and stuff.
New York City?
But I've been to like Wilmington, Delaware, York, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
When you get into the city,
yeah.
That's when you find the real drivers and they're like yelling at you. And
the real drivers? The other truck drivers or just the drivers?
If you ever travel down there, as soon as you get to like halfway through Connecticut, the trucks outnumber the cars.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Huh. Oh, yeah, like a lot, but.
Okay.
Truck drivers, especially, I don't have a CB in my truck just because I don't want to listen to all the aggravation, but.
Mm.
But you can see the guy on the side of you, he wants to say something to you because whatever. And I'll be like, no CB, buddy. Have a good day.
Oh. All right. Well, I was thinking about, I give the people that I talk to in the interviews, give them an opportunity to share something that they feel is the best advice that they ever got, or the best advice that they will feel they want to give to someone out there. Somebody all of a sudden starts watching the show and you said you had something that was important to you as a piece of advice. What would that be?
Just to do the right thing. I mean, people are old enough to know, like, right from wrong, like, and just Take the high road, because at the end, it's going to pay off for you.
Okay.
People will see that you're genuine.
Oh, thanks a lot for joining me, Mike. Appreciate it. Appreciate you traveling all the way over here from
Rhode Island. I like how you say all the way.
It's all
like,
the way.
It's well, like a half hour down the road.
It's farther than I am, so.
And
thanks for joining
me. I mean, you're going to get more sleep than I am. And I'll be up before you.
You have to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning.
3 o'clock.
In the morning. Yeah. I also appreciate that. So thanks very much for joining me today, tonight. And thank you, everybody, for joining us. And we'll see you next time when the next person comes and tells this story.